Great. Well, thank you.
Feel free to go ahead.
No great. Problem. Thank you for the introduction. And thanks for joining. My slides will load here in 1 second. Interestingly, my battery died on me on my machine probably about 1 hour ago. So if things go quiet, I'll jump on my iPad and we'll see how it goes. But hopefully my machine doesn't die on me.
Okay.
So as an introduction, we have a new name. So our project is called Open Skill. And this is a Department of Education grant. It's $2.5 million Department of Education grant. Actually, the second round of funding, LibreText was the first round of funding that was provided by the Department of Ed. And I believe there's another grant, OER grant, happening this year. And so this was awarded to Arizona State University. The principal investigator is a professor, Ariel Anbar. And he is based at a Center for Education Through Exploration. And that is a center at the university. And what are we doing? So we are, my slides are a little lag here, but we are doing active OER. So within this center and with the partners that we have in this project, we have a deep history of building learning experiences that are very learning by doing, active learning based. So our emphasis is to bring more of that to OER. It's not that there is none, but there is a general perception from our, from what we've seen that a lot of the OER out there is passive. And it's, this desire to do active learning is definitely based in a lot of the research around active learning. Doing active learning well at scale in the digital realm is really an ongoing experiment and still something that is very hard to do. Active learning in the classroom with your students is definitely much more intuitive and nothing new, but doing it well at scale with digital resources and then even OER resources, that's kind of really what we're trying to emphasize here. So a lot of what we're producing is really aimed at college level. So there are a series of courses, high enrollment intro courses that we are targeting, but we're also building a series of tools, which I'll go through in a second, that can be used at any level and really at any course, any discipline. So we're trying to make some very interesting scalable tools and have them open and used broadly. So I'll show you what that actually means. Okay, so what we are developing here are what we're calling active tools, which are customizable activities, and they're centered on skills. And then we're building other resources that can augment and wrap around these tools and combine that with the existing OER to make and then hosting them all in a kind of website hub where users can interact with them and use them and even engage with a broader community. So they can be used a la carte or bundled into a course and used as a textbook replacement. And it'll become clearer once I start to show you some of these tools, what that actually means. But just a bit of context, we, as I said, are involved with, the principal investigator is at ASU. And so we have this center that is supporting all the learning design, the development of resources, the building of these tools, with a lot of experience in doing very high quality interactive learning experiences. And then we have three fantastic college partners, essentially the three biggest community college systems in the country. And these are, all three of them are sub awards on this grant. So they have capacity to collaborate with faculty on the ground. So everything that we do is a co-development with faculty, And it's a very large group of faculty, nearing about 100 or so faculty in the end. And they have different roles. They're either subject matter experts and reviewers, or they're actually developers, and they work closely with learning designers at ASU. So there's a very real collaboration on the ground, ensuring that these tools will be useful and map directly to competencies within courses, and then are piloted, and we get feedback and iterate and generate a continuous improvement cycle. There is also an entity called InSpark, and this is supporting instructors. So there is student support, there is professional development, training, and there's a unit at ASU called Learning Enterprise, and this is where InSpark lives, has a lot of experience with supporting instructors at scale and institutions, and was initially started as part of a Gates Foundation grant, a $4.5 million Gates Foundation grant. We will be leveraging some of those resources. So why active? Why active OER? Well, there are a lot of barriers, as you know, to OER. And we have kind of latched on to this idea of of quality and access. So the general perception, whether real or not, is that there is not enough high quality OER out there. So that is one barrier we're trying to address, and then access. So being able to find it, access it, and then even repurpose it and contextualize it into your courses. So these are the barriers that we're targeting. And as I said before, no one will deny that active problem solving, inquiry-based learning is a more effective way to learn. Our challenge is how to do it well at scale. We have actually shifted our project from the beginning from something that was much more focused on textbooks to now something that is still applicable to textbook replacements, but shifting much more towards skills and competencies, competency of those skills. This, for example, is a Department of Ed framework that we are using, one of a few frameworks that we are using. The important thing is that the landscape from our perspective, especially with COVID-19 and the response and the need to educate and re-educate, shift careers, build up skills, competencies, boot camps, nano degrees, whatever you want to call it, this idea of credentialing around skills to improve your employment, that is a shift that was already happening before COVID, and then it just was really, I think, accelerated. And we are trying to target that space as well. So the tools that we build, and these are digital tools used to teach skills and what we're calling essential skills. And you may even call them essential workforce skills. So that really is the crux, kind of the nucleus of everything we are trying to do in this project. We have distilled a lot of different frameworks and also worked with a workforce advisory board that helped us to outline what we think are our essential skills. And then I will show you how these map down into the specific tools that we are developing. So these are the skills. And then here are our tools. So we aim to build four tools. One is a virtual tour tool. The other is a data tool, a peer review tool, and a process planner. And so I'll briefly go through some of these and maybe try and even show one if my computer behaves. And then I'll stop and open up for questions. So the virtual tour, I'm going to jump out of my presentation mode so I can potentially show you something here, is a storytelling tool so that students can jump into a 3D environment and they can actually navigate a 3D environment, move around, and create their own virtual, what we call a virtual field trip. And these are based off some really interesting work that is being done out of the ASU ETX Center, if I can get this to load here. So for example, we have these high resolution images that are GigaPan images, and you can actually create a fully immersive learning experience in these by moving around, clicking on things, and asking students questions. And the idea is that they would themselves build a virtual field trip. Here's another one in Australia, which is actually my home country, which you might be able to notice from my funny accent. And so these are the kinds of learning experiences that we will build and then allow students to kind of develop their own build, in the form of storytelling, and that will be used to teach them creativity, innovation, cultural awareness, technical proficiency. Then the next tool, which I'll try and bring up here. Apologies, there's quite a bit of a lag on my machine. Okay, so while this is coming up, I'll just talk to the next tool. The next tool is a data tool. So that's going to help students with data visualization and navigating data, getting comfortable with data. And in all of these tools, the important piece is that you can build your own assignment in the tools. And so any instructor can come in and customize the tool, make it their own, build an assignment, and then take it to the next level, contextualize it for a different course. So the data tool, you can build any kind of assignment in it and then launch it and use it with your students. And all of these are built in to work within any LMS, any Canvas, Blackboard, and it will handle all the account provisioning and student data and then be offered as OER tools. So that is the data tool. I was also then here showing the peer review tool, which is a tool to teach peer review. So students can read other students' assignments, and there's a customizable rubric for instructors to modify and adapt. And then it handles peer review. For those that are familiar, there's a similar tool in Canvas, the LMS, or there are others out there. None are actually OER. So this is the first OER peer review tool that handles assignments, grading, allowing students to review others. Students make comments against a customizable rubric. So peer review tool. And then finally, there's a process planner tool. And the process planner is specifically to teach students how to visualize, organize, chunk up information, and work through some complex task in terms of time and project management. And so again, it's fully customizable. You could have a lab report, you could have a student mapping out their career aspirations, really whatever you like. So that is our tools, and that's what we mean by an active tool. These will all be hosted and provided on the hub when that website becomes available. And an example is kind of a bundle. For example, we have an English composition bundle. That was our first course that we are targeting. And so we have existing OER. We augment it with tools. Inside the tools, there are assignments and different guides. And these use the active, active tools. So we support you and you build assignments inside our tools and augment it with existing OER, which we provide in packages that exist already in Canvas or Blackboard. And so you can kind of use them as is, plug and play as a textbook, or build your own or some combination of the two. So our timeline for the project looks something like this. Once it loads, with most of our tools being available in a beta in spring and summer next year. There'll be a pilot release in fall of next year, and then a general release the following spring, summer in 2022. And that is when we'll have at least 6 full textbook replacements, and then all our tools to be used in other courses. And we're doing this all within what we're trying to do is build it so all of this is open source and using a framework that will hopefully mean that all the content that we build is interoperable, so that it doesn't matter which platform you want to use, it will be able to integrate into any platform. And that is a whole nother presentation that I can't give right now because I'm out of time, but it's a very interesting part of our project where we are working closely with Carnegie Mellon, the Open Learning Initiative, the standard body that generates standards, the global IMS, and you know, Department of Ed and other interested folks like the Gates Foundation, to try and set a de facto standard so that maybe you could one day even email an adaptive lesson and not really worry about where it is and be able to freely share OER and run it in any platform, much like you can email a Word doc right now and not have to worry about whether the person can run it or render it. So thank you very much. I'll stop there for questions. And on the page of this, on the OE Global page, I put some links there where you can actually sign up to keep up to date, or you can just email directly team@inspark.education and the team can help you there. But I do suggest signing up on the website that was put as a comment on that page to keep up to date with everything and the releases of all the tools and full textbooks.
This is amazing, David. Thank you so much for sharing your work. I think that everything that you've been saying, how the tools have been building one to another and how it supports and boosts the use and creation of OER, it just simplifies everybody's lives. So thank you very much for sharing this wonderful work with us. And we do have a couple of minutes for questions. So if anybody has a question for David, please feel free to open your mic or just type it away in the chat. We do have a comment from Catherine saying that she would love to know the names of these tools and if they are ASU owned.
Yeah, good question. The tools themselves will be put out under a Creative Commons license. I think technically anything that is developed under this grant, because it's funded through ASU, I think that technically the IP will have to reside with Arizona State University, but they'll all be provided out with the correct Creative Commons license and the like. I'm not an expert on licensing and things like that, but our goal is actually to provide an open source version of these tools. I believe similar to like an MIT open license. And the tools themselves, there will be a foundational code base that can actually be used by developers to build any tool, and we'll be providing that with documentation. So that's an interesting part of the project. And I put a link in there in the chat where you can actually sign up